today on the book of Luke, the 15th chapter. And I know this is a very familiar scripture dealing with the synoptics, but I'm not going to take it to where the people, anytime they're being formal with the word of God, they always deal with the prodigal son.
Right,
they
right.
always deal with the prodigal son. Amen, amen, amen. But see, I want you to see something that has everything to do with your purpose. There is something about to take place, as one of the God said, that 2022, it has a lot to do with your purpose. And there's a lot of people that's going to hate you because of your purpose.
Jesus.
I dare you look at your neighbor and say, go ahead and welcome me to the fan club.
Go ahead and welcome me to the fan club.
Because you're going to hate me in 2022. Amen, amen, amen. From the book of Luke 15.
Come
chapter.
Out now.
Amen. And we're going to go from the book of, I'm sorry, from the chapter 22 all the way to chapter 32. And the Bible says that, but the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe. And put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring him hither. The fatted calf, kill it. Let us eat and be married. For this is and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be married. And his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called, listen, he called for one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him, and he answering said to his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgress I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might be married with my friends. But as soon as this thy son, oh Jesus, can y'all see the hatred, the malice, the jealousy? As soon as this thy son, it's going to be some thy sons in 2022 and some thy daughters in 2022. As soon as this thy son was come, which have devoured his living with heart lust, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Jesus. Listen, I'm not going to go into hoopology and try to be the next T.D. Jakes or Noel Jones or whatever the case may be, but I'm going to break this word down as simple as the Bible says. Amen. It is as easy to the understanding as you read it. Amen, amen, amen. It's a simple message. Listen, I want you to understand. Amen. Hallelujah, Lord. Let me give honor to God. Father God, we just come to you today, Lord God, as we embrace your word, embrace your purpose, embrace this new year, Lord God. Lord, we pray in this hour, Lord God, that we may be found faithful in thy sight, Lord God. We pray in this hour, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that you work the word today, Lord God. Lord God, we pray that you manifest your word as it has been declared. The word of God in the name of Jesus is good for reproof. It's good for doctrine. It's good for, in the name of Jesus, everything that the man needs to be made whole, Lord God. Father, we honor you in this hour, in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. As we get ready to go into this new year, it is essential that we understand our need for meaningful emplacement. For meaningful emplacement. 2022, you can't be in no position to where it's not meaningful. That means you got to cut some people off. Oh, come on. I know some of y'all not ready to cut off people because y'all so connected to them. I'm not ready to let you go yet. But you have to be in a meaningful position in order for God to be able to do what he's getting ready to do in 2022.
Yes, Lord.
Listen, my pastor told me, and God knows I was talking to her yesterday, and she said, son, I heard from the Lord.
Come on now.
She said, son, the Lord said 2022, you better know his voice. Listen, that means that some of them people that are telling you some stuff now, you better, come on, smiley. You might want to go on and go ahead and predate your now. This relationship is over. I can't say anything else to you in 2022. Listen, we have to understand that the, in the name of Jesus, the meaningful emplacement has to be a place that is definable to the stance that we take. It has to be definable. It has to be meaningful and definable. That means that it has to be a position that makes sense to God and not make sense to you. Y'all don't miss this. Because the way that God moves, he don't move in our time. In the name of Jesus. He don't move in our time, but he move in his. And see, that's what we get messed up at. Because we so busy trying to move in our own time that we mess up our own steps. But do you not know that the Bible says that the water of us, in the name of Jesus, the steps of a good man are watered by the Lord. Oh, come on, somebody. That means that no matter step that you take, God say, I'm going to put a roadblock here, make you bust your head, and you have to. Oh, come on, somebody. Listen, I learned the hard way. Do y'all remember them old Nokia phones?
Yes.
And it started with that little snake with one little button.
Yes.
And you got to keep on and keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
And then you try to, in the name, just make sure you trace your steps. And then you run into that roadblock. Because why? You wasn't paying attention at the end of it. You was too busy trying to make it. That's the way that God moved. God say, don't try to get ahead of me.
Yes.
You let me order your steps.
Yes.
You let me order your steps, because when I order your steps, Lord have mercy.
Yes.
Let me go on and slow this thing down, because I don't want to get ahead of myself. Listen, you have to understand, whatever your definable stance is, it has to speak to your ability to be creative, charismatic, humble, modest, penitent, because a lot of us need to be repentant. Come on, somebody. Or it can be one that speaks fluently of your disposability, to where everything about you is disposal. God come into your life and he got to dispose things. Oh, come on, somebody. He got to dispose things in your life. He got to dispose you out of broken relationships. He got to dispose you out of, oh, come on, somebody, connections that don't mean you no good. He got to dispose you out of these things. Because the stance that you took, it was not definable. Amen, amen, amen. It was not of the moment that speaks to your significance. Because the Bible says that in the Word of God that you were fearfully and wonderfully made. Oh, come on, somebody. See, you too busy looking at yourself in the mirror saying, I'm nobody and I'm nothing. But God said that you was fearfully and wonderfully made. I don't see no way in scripture. God says that when he looked at himself, that he seen an ugly image. Oh, come on, somebody. When he looked at himself, he was so proud he spit out multiplicity of himself all throughout the land. He said, yeah, let me throw some of my potential over here, and some of my purpose over here, and some of my beauty. Oh, come on, somebody. And see, a lot of us don't see it because we connected to some disposable potential that you got to discard because it ain't no good. But listen. You got to understand that anything that is disposable, it leads you to a position to where you become discreditable. Your name becomes so discreditable that it leaves a sour taste in everybody's mouth. Y'all don't miss this. Y'all ever had some grits without salt? Oh, it's nasty. Ooh, it's nasty. Have you ever had a potato and you didn't put the rock salt on it? Let me take it there. All of us are African Americans and we love crabs. Have you ever had crabs without Old Bay seasoning? Oh, come on, somebody. It'll make you spit the whole pot. But listen to what the word of God said, that Jesus said that in the word of Matthew 5 and 13, ye are the salt of the earth.
Amen.
But if the salt have lost his savior, wherewith shall it shall be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and be trodden under the feet of men. And you still trying to figure out why everybody got their foot on your neck.
Oh,
just missed it. Because you have not took a definable stance that says that for God I live and for God I die.
The word, preaching news.
Oh, Jesus.
The word.
Uh-huh. As we journey into the word of life, I want to ascribe of many great people that was in the same position that you and I were in, whether they were big or small. I want to define the defining moments to where they came into an encounter with God, his grace, his mercy, his all-encompassing power, and his compassion. Listen, now we're talking about the prodigal son and the mistake that he made and the hatred that came because he came in contact with somebody who knows how to forgive you of your sins. Uh-huh. See, we look for the wrong people to forgive us. You're looking for your friend to forgive you. You're looking for Pookie to forgive you. You're looking for Ray Ray to forgive you. You're looking for Shaniqua to forgive you. But nobody bent their knees and tried God. Lord, have mercy. We're talking about those defining moments that speaks to your significance, that speaks to the essence of who you are. Listen, Pharaoh, Exodus 10, 16. Then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron in haste. And he said, I have sinned against the Lord your God and against you. Now, therefore, forgive, I pray thee, my sin only this once. We're talking about defining moments. And entreat the Lord your God that he may take away this death from me only. Listen. Only he realized that his defining moment required life and he was in a dead situation. Y'all don't miss this because a lot of us still remain in dead situations and we need the life bearer. But how do we get it? How do we get it? The Bible says that and Moses went from Pharaoh and entreated the Lord, and the Lord turned a mighty strong west wind. Don't miss it. So that means when you repent to God, he comes in and he saves.
Oh, y'all just missed it.
He comes in and he saves.
Yeah.
Oh, miss this. He comes in and he saves you. He will move whatever mountain is in your way that's preventing you to go forward. He will move it out of your way. Oh, come on, somebody. I wish I had some folk in here. That in the name of Jesus, I'm talking about some of them old time folks that got on the altar and stayed there all night long.
Yeah.
I ain't moving till I know that God has changed my life. I'm not moving till I know he has came in. Oh, come on, somebody. As my wife said, I'm not moving until he breathed a rock into my life. Oh, come on, somebody. Because I need the anointing of God to bring me out of the sin that I'm in to take me level. My life. I wish I had a church today. Because what it is the enemy wants to cause you to escape the defining moments. Oh, come on, somebody. You ever been in the world? And every time somebody told you about God, somebody else came in your ear, hey, man, you're going to the club tonight. Hey, man, you're going to smoke some weed with me tonight. Man, you're going to drink with me tonight. And you just... just sat home with your mom watching TBN and hearing the word of God and done something to you, but the enemy came in and called you to escape your defining moment. But sometimes you gotta go out there so far that you ain't got nobody to remind you of what you used to do. Y'all don't listen. Sometimes you gotta go so far, man of God, that you can't hear what they got to say no more. Sometimes you gotta be pushed so far out there that you can't be thinking about Pookie and Ray Ray no more. I don't care what they had to make you feel good. I don't care how many times they gave it to you. But God will let you go so far that you end up by yourself. I wish I had some people in the house of God, but I don't want to bore you. But listen what the Bible says. And the Lord turned a mighty strong wind, which took away the locusts. Oh, Jesus. Some of y'all still worry about them shackles on your feet. If you repent today, God said, I remove the shackles. I remove the chains. I remove the dead weight that's all around you. And I'll pick you up out of the miry and the muck and the clay. And I'll change your name. I'll place you on a rock. Oh, Jesus. And the Bible says that what happened was is he threw it into the Red Sea. And he cast them into the Red Sea. And they remained not one locust in all the coast. Listen, let me give you another illustration.
Yes, Lord.
There was in the Word of God, book of Joshua, the 7th chapter. Yes. When Achan was the one that he began to lust after. Something that was not godly. Now let's go there. Because a lot of us got some lustful eyes and we looking at the things as not godly. That's it. And the Bible says that and Joshua said to Achan. Now, mind you, now this was after the decree was made when God began to speak to Joshua. And he said, Joshua, whoever this is that has brought sin in camp, I want you to kill them, kill their belongings, kill everything, because they brought sin in the camp. Let me take it back a little bit further. They thought they was going to go beat Ai, and he sent 30,000. And the Bible says when he sent them, the Bible says that, oh God, in the name of Jesus, say for the blood of Jesus, he says that 45 came back. Say for the blood of Jesus. 45 was defeated. But what happens is they went back to Joshua and said, Joshua, normally we would defeat the enemy. Y'all don't miss this. He says, normally we will defeat the enemy when we go out united together. But we have lost some along the way. And he said, well, there's been something has had to happen. Something has had to happen. Now, what has happened? So he put a decree out and said that whoever this may be, we're going to kill everything that they have. Now, let's go to the scripture. And he said, and Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel. Don't miss this. And make confession. This is where y'all missed this at. Because we don't want to make confession no more. But he says, make confession unto him. And tell me now what thou hast said. I'm sorry. Tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord. Ooh, come on, somebody. Open confession is what is good for the soul. I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel. And thus I have done when I saw among the spoils, in the name of Jesus, when I saw among the spoils a godly Babylonian garment and 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold of 50 shekel weight, then I coveted. Y'all just missed it. He said, then I what? I
coveted.
Yeah, a lot of y'all still coveting around Pookie and Ray Ray. But after the night, you're going to leave Pookie and Ray Ray alone. Listen what he said. He said, then I coveted and I took them, and behold, they are in the earth, in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. And we know the story, how God went and he told Joshua, go ahead, call them by families. And the family that come to you and expose the truth, then I want you to kill them. We all know the story. He got stoned. His whole family got burned. Everybody gone. But look at how God does this. Because of Achan's confession, God turns around and come back in Hosea. And he says, I will give her vineyards from this. and the valley of Achor, which is the place where Achan was buried at. Oh, come on, somebody. See, when you go to God and you openly confess to God the very thing that you know that you got no business doing, God will redeem. Oh, God will redeem you.
Yes,
and listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says that an Achor shall be a door of hope. It's not going to be a dead place anymore. It's not going to be a sorrowful place anymore. It's not going to be a vengeance place anymore. But it's going to be a place of hope. And she shall sing there as in the days of her youth, and as in the days when she came up out of the land of Egypt. And in all, and it shall be all that day, said the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishai. And no more shall you call me Baali. And Ishai means my husband. And the Bible says that he is married to the backslider. So God said, you're not going to fear me as your master, but you're going to love me. Oh, come on, somebody. You're going to love me as your husband. You're going to embrace me as the one that loved me. I wish I had some folk in the house of God, but let me slow this thing down some. David said in Psalms 51, have mercy upon me, O Lord, or according to thy loving kindness and according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly, and mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this thing, this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when you speak. God said that if you open your mouth and confess to me, that you don't need Pookie, you don't need Ray, but all you need is the great that I am. I'm trying to take my time, but it's just something about knowing that we serve a God that is forgiving, a God that is loving kind, and he forgive according to his tender mercies. And this is why the blind man said that when he heard that Jesus was coming, they tried to shut him up, and he said, Jesus, the Son of David, have mercy on me. And I promise you, son experience. Oh, come on, somebody. Because you can't have the haters until you turn. I'm hoping somebody. You can't have the haters until you turn around. You can't have the, oh, come on, somebody. You can't have those hating on you until you say, I got to get my life together. Listen. I'm going to slow this thing down. But I want you to know something. After the prodigal son had an epiphany, and he realized that his final thought was about to be his reality. That's why the Bible says that think on these things that are loving, that are kind, that are pure. Oh, come on, somebody. These things that have virtue. He realized that his final thought was about to be his reality. And see, here is the problem that we have today. We allow our final thought to be the conclusion. Oh, come on, somebody. When you make the final thought your conclusion, then you become subjective. Y'all don't miss this. You become subjective to the chaos that you accept in your life. The Bible says that the prodigal son, he basically stated, he said that now he's sinking. And he says that I am so hungry that I will eat the pig slot that the king, that in the name of Jesus, that the pigs eat. I should eat this very thing. But then he came to himself. Y'all don't miss this. See, a lot of us lose because we don't come to ourselves fast enough. Woo, Jesus. I'm going to tell you like I learned. This is what the Baptist folk do. Anytime they exalted and preaching the word of God, they do like what we do. We come to the edge and tee the top. and see just how far we can go without falling. I'm going to tee it a tot. But see, you going to mess around and keep playing with that very thing until it make you fall right in your face. Oh, Jesus. Listen, look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I don't have to become what I least likely desire. Oh, Jesus, y'all don't need this. You ain't got to become what you least likely desire. Y'all don't need this. You ain't finna go to no car lot and buy no beat up Toyota when you got the money to buy a Mercedes. Y'all don't miss this. You ain't finna go and purchase no rundown two-bedroom mobile home when you got money to purchase a mansion. A lot of us subject ourselves to what we least likely desire. That's why we end up in relationships to where we got these men that want to bust our head wide open. We got women want to cheat on us left and right because it's what we least likely desire. Y'all don't miss this. A lot of us have connected to what we have least likely desired. You know, even in your right mind, you want to be caught with that person in the movies. They got to turn the lights on at some time and realize what you're walking next to. Hope I'm helping somebody. Listen, the Bible says that, and he would have gladly filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. Here is a man that subjected himself to carry the burden of defeat, both inwardly and outwardly. And a lot of us still carrying the burden of defeat, both inwardly and outwardly. After we have taken our life prematurely, after we wandered and failed and settled, after we demoralized ourselves, and now we're left emotionally rich and bankrupt in our soul. You got more emotions than a bag of rocks. You heavily weighted with emotions. Ain't nobody trying to understand you, because all I hear is click. Just go somewhere and sit down somewhere.